بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear brothers and sisters, we welcome you to another episode of the subject of the hereafter, and specifically the subject and topic of the hellfire and the things that lead people to the hellfire. And we seek refuge in Allah from the traps that lead people to the hellfire. We mentioned in the previous episode about some of the things that lead people to the hellfire, some of the sins, and how most people who enter the hellfire are there because they are carefree in this life. They do not allow themselves to become disciplined human beings with morals and principles. And this is very common in our day and age, where people are not willing to control their nafs, willing to control their souls. Rather, they are letting their nafs run free. And when you allow your nafs to control you and to run free, you will indulge in so many sins and problems. And this is why our society is becoming corrupt. And mankind is going down this dangerous path. And we seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from being exposed to this path. Now, we also started discussing some of the ways we can change ourselves. Some of the ways we can improve to avoid these sins. And so we have to also begin with the excuses that people usually have. Most people begin their lives anytime someone comes to them with a good reminder, they begin with the subject of excuses. Why? Because if you have an excuse, then you will not put in any effort whatsoever. If you have an excuse, then you don't care. You don't want to try. It gives you a reason, a justification to stay where you are in life. And this prevents us from improving as human beings and as believers and as people who want to avoid the path that leads to the hellfire. So some of the excuses that people have, they cause them to reach a state of inactivity. So the person might start blaming Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will blame the Creator and they will say that these deeds that I've committed are because of Allah. Meaning, and this is what Imam Ibn Qudama says, to say my evil deed is not my fault but the fault of Allah, because Allah created me, is like a person having a child, a baby outside of wedlock, meaning adultery. And this person says, I'm not going to pay for this child or support this child because Allah created this child. And so this is an insult and a mockery against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is that justifiable? Absolutely not. And so you took the steps to commit the sin. You took the steps to do what you did, so you cannot blame anyone else, including the Creator. Other excuses that usually come up is, I was born this way. This is how I was born. And some people will say, I am not from a religious family, or I'm not even from a Muslim family, despite the fact that many of the greatest Sahaba, most of their families were not Muslim as well. So Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says very beautifully in his book Al-Fawaid, he says, Abu Talib drowned in the seas of misguidance, while Salman, the Persian Salman al-Farisi, was safe on the coast. He says, Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira, the honor of the Arabs, he preceded all of them in straying away from Allah, while Suhaib, the Roman, excelled above all Arabs. He said, Al-Najashi, while in Abyssinia, he called, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik. He called, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik. And Bilal, the slave, he used to say, As-salatu khayrun min an-nawm. Prayer is better than sleep. And so, he says, Abu al-Hakam, later on became Abu Jahl because he fell deaf and ignorance surrounded him. So now he is Abu Jahl because of his ignorance and he is the father of ignorance. So another believed in Allah, despite never seeing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Abdullah ibn Ubay, he prayed behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam for many years. And yet, he died as a disbeliever. He dies as a hypocrite. There are no excuses for us whatsoever. You look at the different examples, and you have to realize, it is not about where you are from, or your lineage, or your culture, or your society, or your parents. It does not matter. All that matters is your willingness to turn to the Creator for help. Bilal heard his master Umayyah cursing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he learned that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was calling people to tawheed, to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at a time when people worshipped idols. And so he became Muslim, and he was tortured in the scorching heat of the desert, and he was on the verge of death. And he continued to say, Ahadun Ahad. There's only one God. One God. That is all that he knew. That is all that he believed in. And so later on, Umar radiallahu anhu, he asked Bilal in the golden age, he said, our master who was freed by our master, why when you were being tortured, were you only saying ahadun ahad? Why were you saying ahadun ahad? So Bilal responded, by Allah, if I had known anything other than the one ahadun ahad, I would have said it. I did not know any of the other names of Allah or the attributes of Allah to say it. And so you think about it. If you want your heart to turn towards Allah, it is not about the amount of knowledge that you have. It is about your sincerity in turning to Allah. Bilal radiallahu anhu did not have all the books of hadith that we have. Bilal did not know all the rulings of fiqh. He did not know how to pray. He knew there was one God and he believed in it sincerely. And that sincerity is what will protect you as a believer. That is what will help you get to paradise. So when your heart turns towards Allah, when you turn towards Allah, Allah will guide you. Allah will take care of you. You take one step towards Allah, Allah will take many steps towards you. Now we have a beautiful story from a man in the past in one of the Western nations where he went to the masjid as a disbeliever. He came to the masjid and he walks in with his shoes and he says, I want to become a Muslim. I want to become a Muslim. He looked like he was panicking, like he was in a hurry. They asked him, do you know anything about Islam? He said, I don't, but I know that Islam is the truth. He was guided to that masjid. He wants to become Muslim. All he feels in his heart is sincerity towards Islam and towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the imam gave him the shahada. So he said the shahada. So he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah alone. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the servant of Allah. Now this man was so happy, he started crying. He broke down into tears. And he hugged the people. And as they were leaving, they gave him some books so he can benefit from them, such as the Why Islam literature. And he walks outside and he's saying salam to the people. He's telling them good night. And then what happens? A car hits him and he passes away. He dies on the spot. And the last thing that he did was that he turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah accepted from him. He was so sincere. He did not pray a single prayer. He did not pray a single prayer. He did not make wudu one time in his life. He did not fast a single day in his life. And yet his sincerity in turning towards the Creator, Allah accepted that turn towards the Creator and gave him Islam. And he died on the Shahada. He died on the Shahada, never having committed any sins. Meaning, once you enter Islam, your sins are wiped out. So this man embraced Islam. Now he has no sins. And now he dies and returns back to the Creator. So he's in a great position, a great status, because of his sincerity, because of his goodness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what that man went through in his life to be such a good person that he dies right after he becomes Muslim. Right after he submits to the Creator. So Allah wanted this man to change because this man wanted to change. This man wanted Allah, so Allah wanted this man to change and embrace his religion. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us and told the Sahaba about a man who lived in Medina. This man shows up at the battle of Badr and he starts to fight with them. And so they ask him if he was fighting for Allah or for nationalism, meaning because he's patriotic. He said he was there for the Creator, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he took the shahada. Notice, he came and he's saying that he's fighting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he takes the shahada as they're at the battle of Badr. He becomes Muslim right there. And he dies in that battle. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would often ask, who was the man? Who was the man who died as a shaheed? And he entered Jannah without having prayed a single prayer. And without having ever made a single wudu or without fasting a single day. And so this man, he did not make any excuses. He did not make any reasons not to turn to Allah. So what are you and I doing in order to turn to Allah on a daily basis? What excuses are we giving ourselves? What justification are we putting in our path as an obstacle in order to get to Allah? We are putting our own obstacles in our own paths. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to turn to Him. If you want Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow you to change. And so the first of many excuses that people have is, we were born this way. And this is very common in our day and age, more than even in the past. People say, I was born this way. Born this way is a very common phrase used in some societies to emphasize what? To emphasize that I was born this way, so let me be. Let me be this way. Don't tell me I cannot do anything. Let me be who I am. Let me be unique. Let me be different. Let me indulge in sins. Let me try to stick out. Let me do whatever I want because I was born this way. So they will blame what? They will blame the creation of themselves being born this way so they cannot control it. They cannot tame it. They cannot discipline themselves. Imam al-Ghazali rahimahullah years ago talked about this excuse, born this way. So what does he say? He said, people say that this excuse, my khuluq is like my khalq. So we make a prayer often. We make a prayer often. What do we say? Oh Allah, as you have beautified our exterior, our khalq, beautify our character. Allahumma kama ahsanta khalqi, ahsan khuluqi. So these people will have this excuse, and this dua is very well known. Again, the dua is, oh Allah, as you have beautified my exterior, my khalq, as you hasanta khalqi, ahsan khuluqi. Allow my character to be beautified. So you're saying, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can allow me to be beautified. You can allow me to change. Khuluq is your interior and your character and your inner beauty. And Al-Ghazali says, some people will say they are born with a hot temper, meaning their temper breaks down easily. And so they will say they are raised in this environment. Their parents were like this, or the people around them were like this. So they will make the excuse that changing the khuluq is like changing the khalq. Changing the character and the manners and the state of the heart is like changing the creation, meaning changing the actual human being. They say if you try to change it, then you will end up in a worse situation than before. And so this is an excuse that people have, and it is invalid. Because you can change, and you can ask Allah to help you change, and you can make the dua for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you change. Allahumma kama hassanta khalqi ahsan khuluqi. The second excuse that people have is self-pity. Self-pity. So we feel too sorry for ourselves at times as Muslims to do things. So some people, they will say, I'm going to lose all my friends if I do this or if I do that. I'm going to lose all my friends. Or people will look at me like I'm funny or strange. Or I cannot pray in public, so I'm going to pray in the car. So people come up with all of these different excuses. And so we live in a time where people are filled with these excuses, at a time when it's severe as a situation to be Muslim. And yet we feel sorry for ourselves, and so that prevents us from changing. One beautiful quote that one of the disbelievers actually said is the following. She said, self-pity is a death that has no resurrection. She said, a sinkhole from which no rescuing hand can grab you, because you have chosen to sink. You have decided to sink. Nothing can help you. No one can save you. Nothing will take you from that sinking hole. So when you decide to sink, then nothing will help you get out. But when you decide to change, and you decide to be rescued, and you decide to improve as an individual, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you change if you put in the required effort. We're going to take a short break, inshallah ta'ala. When we get back, we'll continue with the third excuse and some of the hows and whens of changing so that we don't fall into these traps. We'll be right back, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Praising every day.
A friendly message by Dr. Zakir. The most profitable business.
Would you like to know the business in which you earn the maximum profit? The secret is given in the glorious Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 261. The example of those who spend their wealth in the way of Allah is like a seed of grain, which grows 7 spikes. In each spike is 100 grains. And Allah multiplies His reward to whom He wills. If you spend your wealth in the way of Allah, you'll get a return of 700 times. In business terminology, you'll get a profit of 70,000%. Is there any business you know of in which you'll get a better return? Invest today in the way of Allah.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
Say He is Allah, one and only. Allah, the absolute and eternal. He begets not, nor is He begotten. There is nothing like Him.
Focus on the source of wisdom.
The Quran is a magnet, and the Sunnah is a revelation. Islam had the solution right from the beginning. We apply that, and the problem is solved.
Focus on the solution for our world.
There is no man on the face of earth. His life was narrated to us like Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Poor, rich, white, black, Arab, non-Arab, everybody say the same word. Obey Allah, obey the messenger.
Focus on the Akhirah.
Tawbah is mandatory upon each and every Muslim.
Success for the Muslim is having the correct belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Allah has power over all things.
Focus on the facts and realities that motivate the world towards Islam. In Islam in Focus, next on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Before we took a short break, we started discussing some of the excuses that people have in order to prevent themselves from changing. And so one of these excuses that we mentioned is the excuse that I was born this way, so I cannot change. And this is very common, especially in our day and age, when people are emphasizing that they are born this way. So this gives them reason to be different or to do something prohibited or immoral. Another excuse that people have in order to prevent themselves from actually changing and putting in the effort to change is the excuse of self-pity. So they feel sorry for themselves. They actually sympathize with themselves, so that prevents them from ever changing and improving. The third excuse that we'll mention for today, inshallah, is the excuse of blaming the religion for flaws based on the religious people. What does that mean? So you see the flaws of religious people, somebody you interacted with in the past, maybe some sheikh or some alim that lied or did something inappropriate. So what will some people say? They will say, oh, all these people are evil. All these sheikhs are evil. All this and this and this. And they will have excuse after excuse for using these excuses in order not to turn back to the religion. So they will use people as their symbolism of religion. Some people will say the excuse of, these people, they leave the masjid and they go do sins. So why should I follow them? Why should I be religious? So they have this excuse where they blame the people for their own flaws in not turning back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now let us mention some of the hows of change and the whens of change. How some things change and how we cannot change some things and when we can change some things. The first and the very obvious is the things that cannot be changed, like the sun and the moon. You cannot change the sun and the moon. The second is the things that have potential, but if they are not nourished properly, they will go to waste. If they are not nourished properly, they will go to waste. So for example, you will hear someone talking about someone else, and they will say, MashaAllah, so-and-so did this and did that, but they can do more, or but they did not do this, or but they're missing out on something. What is that thing that is potential? So you know that there's wasted potential. One of the scholars of the past, he said very beautifully, he gave the example that you cannot plant a date seed and expect to grow apples. And you cannot plant an apple seed and expect to grow dates. Everyone has unique qualities, the people's emotions and their traits and their characteristics in a certain way. And so if a person had leadership qualities, what did the Prophet ﷺ do? He would put them in positions where they can shine as leaders. And so a beautiful example of that is Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu. He was known to be a good leader and a teacher, a scholar. And so the Prophet ﷺ sent him to teach people. And we also know the example of Ja'far radiallahu anhu. He was eloquent and he was only 21 years old, but he was sent to Habasha. And the Prophet ﷺ said, people are like precious stones. The best of you in ignorance is the best of you in Islam if they understand and comprehend. The third thing is things that are harmful, but they can be destroyed with effort ranging from very little to very great. So sometimes you can attain certain qualities, especially the longer you have been in it, but it can be changed and worked on. So sometimes you can attain certain qualities, especially the longer you have been in it, but it can be changed and worked on. Number four are things that can go both ways, meaning it's something that can go in either direction. For example, the internet. This is a very common example. If you're using the internet or social media to post something inappropriate, something, for example, that is haram, then this is something that is pulling you in the wrong direction. And now if you use it for da'wah or to help other people, Muslims and non-Muslims alike, then this is something that you're using for good. So this is something that can go in either direction and you are choosing to use it for good. Imam al-Dhahib rahimahullah narrates in his biography of the Noble Companions a story of a man who used to be a singer. A man who used to be a singer by the name of Jad'an. So one day Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he was passing by this man and he heard him singing. What did Abdullah say? He said, if only this man would use his voice to recite the Quran. So this man heard what Abdullah said and he started to cry. And he ran after Abdullah ibn Mas'ud and he became one of his students and became one of the pious people. So anger is good if it's used in something that is displeasing to Allah. Jealousy is good if you try to act productive so that no one surpasses you in faith. Generosity is good as long as the giver, the one donating generously, does not put himself in debt or harms his family. Courage is good as long as it does not make you arrogant. So humility is good as long as it doesn't become disgrace. And that is what shaitan was lacking, and that is what leads to the hellfire. So make your desires conform to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Remember when the Prophet ﷺ said, "No one of you truly believes until his desires conform with what I have brought." None of you truly believes until your desires conform with what I brought, meaning the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so you start to desire good. Now how far could you possibly be from reaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from becoming pious or righteous, from changing to become a better individual? So the scholars, some of them say that there are four situations or stations that you can be at that are far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Four different states that you can be in. The first is simple ignorance. Jahil basit. So some people, they are good and they want to come to Allah, but they have simple ignorance. They don't have any knowledge. When you give them da'wah, they become better Muslims more than anyone else. These people are beautiful. But all they have is simple ignorance. They need to seek knowledge. The second station that they mention is compounded ignorance. A lot of ignorance. So a person who is ignorant, because they are a follower by nature, and they are weak and they go with the flow. So this ignorance is being fed to them. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala divides people into two categories, the leaders and the followers. In the hellfire are the weak people and those who fill themselves with pride, and some people just go with the flow. They just follow anything that comes their way. This person is harder to convince than those in the first category of simple ignorance. The third is al-mubtada, the innovator. These are the people who shaitan comes to with innovation right after shirk. So if shaitan cannot get you to commit shirk or kufr in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he would get you to commit a major innovation even before a major sin. So he'll cause you to fall into an innovation in your way of worshipping Allah rather than making you fall into a major sin. So shaitan would rather you commit bid'ah than adultery. He would rather you commit bid'ah than consume interest or the wealth of others. Because when you commit innovation, you don't realize that you're doing it wrong. You don't realize that you're worshipping Allah incorrectly. So you continue with it without repenting. But when you do a major sin, you know it's a major sin. So Sufyan al-Thawri rahimahullah says, a person with innovation never makes repentance, never makes tawbah, because he thinks it is good. They do acts that are not from Allah and not from the sunnah, and they think that this is a way of coming closer to Allah. Maybe they were taught this innovation at a young age. Maybe because of their culture, or their society, or their country, everyone was doing this, so they're also doing it. But this person does not have an excuse, because when you worship Allah, you have to seek knowledge to make sure you're worshiping Him the correct way. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he once found people in the masjid sitting down, making tasbih. And so he threw the things that they were using to make tasbih, the stones, and they said, "All we want to do is good." So Ibn Mas'ud said, "How many people desire to do good?" So you control your nafs, you remove these excuses, you don't have self-pity, you don't have the excuse of, "I was born this way," or "This is how I was born, with this personality," or "This anger," or "This problem in my habits." All of these things can be changed. Again, anything that you do that you don't like, that is a destructive flaw, it can be changed, it can be improved upon. So you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you, and you have to accept that you can change. You have to accept that there are no excuses, and that you cannot blame Allah for creating you. You cannot blame shaitan for misleading you, because you choose ultimately what to do. You have the free will. And so we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who do not have excuses in their lives, so that we can constantly turn back to Allah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us and to make us of Ahlul Jannah. And this concludes our episode. Join us next time inshaAllah ta'ala as we discuss the different types of nafs, the different types of the carnal self, that which pulls you to do things. And then we will discuss a beautiful story of change and a description of change. And then we will help one another inshaAllah ta'ala with actual action items in how to change, pragmatic ways to change ourselves and to stop committing sins, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive us and make us of the people of paradise and protect us from the punishment of the hellfire. Jazakumullahu khaira wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.